Good morning. Welcome. Ushers are standing by to greet our guests. A little strong here. Thank you. Welcome to the service this morning. If you're a first-time visitor, thank you. You came back. If you're not a first-timer, that means you came back. Thank you. Thank you for doing it. Any first-timers, raise your hand and let our ushers get a card to you. Thank you so much. You need a bulletin, holler at them as well. Some answers to prayer. The team made it safely out to Albuquerque, arriving 19 minutes late, according to American Airlines, but safely arriving, and we praise God for that. Eli suggested we pray for rain last Sunday. Do you all remember that? Thank you for that suggestion, Eli. And did God hear an answer? Amen. And I hope you're praying for spiritual revival as well, that God will pour out His blessing on His people and on the community using us to be a blessing. Pray for the mission team. They will be arriving at Broken Arrow Bible Ranch tonight. The kids will be arriving tomorrow. Pray for Kevin as he preaches. Pray for the youth as they serve, the adults that are with him. And the team was in the bulletin last Sunday along with their schedule, but the list is also on the prayer list today, and I hope that you'll be praying for them. We did get news this week that Jackie Knipe fell in her home, one of our shut-in ladies, and she broke her hip and had some surgery and is in Health South recovering. So be praying for Jackie Knipe. In the bulletin is information about several of our fall programs. Be praying for recruiting of Sunday school teachers. And one we have to add, in addition to the need for a pre-K assistant and a kindergarten teacher and assistant, kindergarten first, we need a second and third grade teaching assistant. And we need workers in Awana and in Children's Church and in the nursery. So you ask God where He would have you to work in all of these areas. As we prepare for the fall, Upward program also needs workers, and pray for them. We are praying for Yurik and Anna, who are headed back to Canada on Tuesday, and when they get to the border, they need a visa, right, Yurik, to continue to work in Canada. We'll be praying at the end of the service for that, and Tommy and Mary will be here another week, and then we'll pray for them next Sunday as they return. There is an offering plate in the foyer to allow us to assist Yurik and Anna in their ministry, and if you'd like to give to that, you can put it in the offering plate in the foyer, and any checks, just make them payable to Abingdon Bible Church. Well, we miss Kevin. He carries a lot of responsibility here on Sunday mornings, jiggling a lot of balls. So I was thinking during the night, okay, let's see, is this, all the things that Kevin takes care of. We appreciate him and pray for him this week. But thank you. Thank you, Drew, for leading worship, and the worship team for joining us this morning. And God bless you as you lead us.
Let's stand together and sing this morning.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Nothing but Sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
All right, let's turn and greet one another.
Let's pray. Our Father, how great is the good news that you've entrusted us with. That while nothing else can cleanse us, the blood of Jesus can. In fact, it cleanses us from all unrighteousness. And so we come to you, O God, the Holy Eternal One, through the precious blood of Jesus. We come as undeserving sinners to receive your marvelous grace. makes us your children now. It allows us to live forever with you for eternity. Thank you, Lord, for those who told us about Jesus. Encourage us to tell others of him. Thank you for Tommy and Merrick, Yurik and Anna, and their faithfulness in proclaiming your good news in the places to which you've called them. Thank you for our missionary Paul and Sandy Timlin, their work in training these young servants to go out. We pray you'd bless them as they continue the work they've done for so many years. We are praying, Lord, for our shut-ins. We especially want to pray for Jackie Knipe, who fell and broke her hip, and pray for your healing mercies to her, for recovery so she can be back on her feet and walking again. We pray, Lord, for those that battle disease. For many, it's cancer. We know how difficult that battle can be. Sometimes a short battle and sometimes a long one. But we ask your grace to sustain them. And we ask for faith for them that they will look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Thank you for workers in children's church and nursery and Sunday school and vacation Bible school and Awana and Upward. We thank you, Lord, that you've provided those that are needed to serve through these many years as elders and deacons and church officers. And as we prepare for our fall program, we pray you continue to faithfully provide those workers that are needed. Lay on the hearts of God's people the place of service you have for them. Lord, there are burdens on our hearts that we do not share publicly, but you know. And I pray that you will meet those needs. Sustain us, Lord, in our difficulties. And may the joy of the Lord be on our hearts, Lord, even as we seek your grace to walk difficult paths. Thank you for the gifts of God's people that have sustained the ministry of Abingdon Bible Church this year and in all the years past. I pray, Lord, that you'd bless with work and sufficient income to provide the needs for each family, and I pray that you would continue to use the gifts of God's people to provide for the needs of Abingdon Bible Church and missionaries and other ministries that we support. We pray you'd bless the gift and the giver this morning and meet every need, physically and spiritually. We pray in Jesus' name.
More and give you control. everything. Come and be the Lord of all. All I am or ever hope to be, I surrender. I surrender to the one who loves me more than life. I surrender. Oh, I surrender. Here is my heart. I open it wide to the one who cannot be unfaithful. I now offer you all that I am. Oh, I surrender. Oh, I surrender. From this day on, I'll be in your hands. Ooh, oh, oh, oh. I've been living for myself, and now I want to live for you alone. Come and help me when I'm weak and when my path seems so unknown. You will be beside me still. I know you want what's best for me. So when I want to take control, Lord, please come and help my unbelief. I surrender. I surrender to the one who loves me more than life. I surrender. Oh, I surrender. Here is my heart. I open it wide to the one who cannot be unfaithful. I now offer you all that I am. Oh, I surrender. Oh, I surrender. From this day on, I'll be in your hands. Ooh, from this day on, I'll be in your hands. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender all.
Thank you, Lydia. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, when Christ is concluding the Sermon on the Mount, he says, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." Let's stand together and sing "The Solid Rock" as we think about those words.
hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, His covenant, His blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found. Dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.
The mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend, the agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, Christ your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. By your perfect sacrifice I've been brought near. Your enemy you've made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness know no end. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Lover of my soul, Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you.
Thank you. Children can be dismissed to Children's Church.
Do y'all know this guy right here? In a moment, I'm going to ask you to answer the question, what do you look forward to in heaven? Microphones are headed out to answer that question. What do you think about when you think about heaven? And I'm going to give you Trudy's answer. Trudy said, when I think about heaven, I think about no more goodbyes. No more goodbyes. We love you, buddy. And today, we say goodbye. God bless you. Okay, mics are out there in the balcony and on the floor. What do you think about when you think about heaven? What are you looking forward to in heaven? Stick your hand up. Drew's got the mic. Let's go. Oh, y'all. Okay, nobody's here this morning. Okay, over here. Thank you.
Very thing. And we said that the constant putting down of Satan, the constant, the barbs he gives to you, through even our own family, other people, it's that constant war, spiritual warfare. There will be no more.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Who else? Here's another.
I will no longer have a sin nature.
No longer have a sin. Oh, okay. That'll be a change for all of us, right? Amen. Down here.
We won't have to worry about being saved anymore because we'll already be saved and we'll be in heaven with God.
All right. God bless you. Look forward to you boys coming back to stay with Nan and Poppy again. The boys have been here for 19 days, and we have to say goodbye to them, too. All right, who else? Yes, Bill.
When I think about heaven, it's beyond my comprehension. And as you get older, of course, I'm getting older, as everybody can tell by looking at me, you think more about heaven and God's coming and Jesus is coming, rather, and so forth. But I can't describe it. It's beyond me what I think about.
Thank you, Bill. Somebody upstairs. Yes, sir.
Everlasting peace. Having God and seeing y'all again.
Everlasting peace. Yeah, yes. Okay, Wanda.
I look forward to just being in the presence of God and Jesus Christ and praising them all for eternity.
For eternity, yes. Right behind you, Drew. And then, do you got another one?
I can't wait to see all the Christians and people who have gone before me.
Hey, look forward to time with some of the great saints of God. Yes, there's one. You got another one? There's one right there. And we got one upstairs next.
No more temptation.
No more Yeah, all right. Go ahead, Chris.
No more pain or suffering of loved ones.
Yes. All right. Thank you, men with the microphones. Find your Bibles. And there's so much. Bill's got one more, Drew. Just give it to Bill, and then we'll find your Bibles and turn to Revelation 21. We'll try to see what we can say about heaven.
I've had a ball in this life. And the Word tells me that the next life is going to be so much more blessed. So I'm a winner both ways. I've already had this one. And I know what's ahead of me. So and I've got things that I thought I couldn't do without, and now I wondered what I ever wanted with them. So if we know the Lord is our personal Savior, all we can do is look forward, because there's a lot of joy ahead. And I'm very much in debt to the Abingdon Bible Church for 66 years of guessing on nursing home. And it's certainly been a blessing to me, and I know it's been a blessing to everybody. Thank you.
65 this year. And when I went to Keisha's grandmother's funeral this week, and you be praying for her family and the loss of her loved one, they sang the song, "I'm a winner either way, whether I go, if I go, or if I stay." Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But we are looking forward to heaven. Amen. All right. So in Revelation 21 and 22, John tells us a little bit about heaven. There's a lot more. We're just going to get a little taste of it this morning. But you've mentioned some of the wonderful things about heaven. Now, can you think about some beautiful places? Urich told us a while ago that it's beautiful up in Yukon. And most anywhere you go, you can see things of beauty. Maybe it's a sunrise, a sunset, a beautiful mountain scene with the snow on the mountain, or maybe the wide array of colors in the fall. Maybe it's the seashore, or water rushing over a waterfall, or a full moon. The beauties of this earth are great. But do you know, I believe that heaven is going to be a place of unsurpassed beauty. So if you're taking notes this morning, beauty fills the first line. I think the Bible tells us that heaven is going to be a beautiful place. A place of unsurpassed beauty. You know, the Bible tells us that eventually there's coming a time when God's going to destroy the world we live in now. And why would he destroy it if he wasn't going to make something better, right? Something more beautiful, more holy, more honoring to God. Peter tells us the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. The heavens will pass away with a great noise. The elements will melt with fervent heat. The earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. All of this is coming to an end. The heavens will be dissolved, being on fire. The elements will melt with fervent heat. Then Peter adds these words, "Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth," and then he adds this phrase, "in which righteousness dwells." A new heaven and a new earth. Now, John begins to describe the creation of the new heaven and the new earth in Revelation 21. He says, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea." 75% approximately of our current world is covered with water. What will it be like? A different kind of life when water is not the dominant need in that society. No more sea, even though there is, as we'll see, the pure river of the water of life. Notice verse 2. "I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband." Now, when you read the Bible, you come up with a lot of questions, do you? I do. And Van, sometimes I can't find the answers. Now, I tried to get the answer to this question this week, and I sort of did, but sort of didn't. And in the chapter we're reading, it's describing this place it's calling New Jerusalem. So what's the relationship of the new heavens, the new earth, the New Jerusalem? And I'm going to end my sermon make the assumption that they are one and the same. Though it's possible that the New Jerusalem is, some would suggest, the capital of the new heavens and the new earth, but it certainly describes for us what the new earth and the new heavens will be like. So I'm going to make kind of that equation this morning, that what we have described here is a description of what we look forward to when we're going to be in the presence of God forever, and you'll see why as we go along. Notice it's a prepared place. It's prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. How long does that take? How long does it take for a lady to get ready for her wedding? You know, I'm always surprised. Be there at 5 a.m. for the wedding at 5 p.m. You know, we want to give her time to get ready. Jesus left a day or two ago, right? He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. We'll end the sermon with the fact that heaven is a place of unending fellowship. But Jesus said, where I am, there you may be also. Heaven is prepared like a bride on her wedding day. Every bride wants to be gorgeous at her best on her wedding day. So heaven is going to be a beautiful place. Now, another one of the questions in this text is, so who's this bride? And I reject the answer that limits the bride here in Revelation 21 to the church. I think in eternity, there's going to be one people of God, one family of God. The bride in eternity will be Old Testament saints, New Testament saints, tribulation saints, millennial saints. It'll be when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in, oh Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in, all of God's people. Heaven is going to be prepared for God's people, a prepared place for a prepared people. Notice in verse 10, let's pick it up in verse 9. One of the angels, seven angels who had the seven bowls filled with seven last plagues, came to me and talked with me, saying, come, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. Carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. Someone suggests that this means that it's already there. God is preparing it now, and then the time will come when the existing universe, that's the heavens, and the existing earth are destroyed, not the dwelling place of God. Remember, there's the heavens of the birds, the heavens of the stars, and the heaven of God. I believe the new heavens and the new earth is all this universe, not the dwelling of God, of course, but the universe is to be destroyed, and God's going to create this new heavens and new earth having the glory of God. Verse 11, her light was like a most precious stone, like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Now, if you know what jasper looks like, this isn't that. That word jasper here is not the word that we normally use for the jasper stone. This word describes a clear, brilliant stone that grooms buy and brides receive. This, I think, is the word for a diamond. So heaven is as beautiful as like a diamond. I mean, a big one, to say the least. The construction, verse 18, the construction of its wall was of jasper. The city was pure gold, Wow! What a beautiful place. Verse 12, she had a great high wall with 12 gates and 12 angels at the gates. And what are those gates made out of? Verse 21, the 12 gates are 12 pearls. Each individual gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, like transparent glass. Wow, what a beautiful place. The gates of heaven are always open, verse 25 says. They'll not be shut at all by day, and there's no night there. And going back to the foundations in verse 12, the foundations, let's see, there's 12 gates. And verse 12 says, the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel on the 12 gates, 3 gates to the east, 3 to the north, 3 to the south, 3 to the west. The wall of the city had 12 foundations. On them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So if you put the 12 tribes and the 12 apostles, the leaders of the Old Testament, leaders of the New Testament together, I think you've got all the people of God. All the people of God in the presence of God for eternity. Notice the foundations of the wall, the beautiful stones in 19, 20, and 21. We won't take time to describe all those beautiful stones that accentuate the beauty of heaven. Notice verse 16, the city is laid out as a square. Its length as great as its breadth. And he measured the city with the reed 12,000 furlongs. How far is that? Well, that's way up to about Connecticut. So if it's that wide and that long, and then notice the end there of verse 16, its length, breadth, and height are equal. So again, we have a little debate. Is this a cube? Or is it a pyramid? Or what is this? I'll tell you what it is. It's big and beautiful. It's big and beautiful. It's a beautiful place. A little girl had been blind from birth, but eventually they were able to perform surgery on this young girl's eyes, and for the first time in her life, she was able to see. And when they removed the bandages and she was able to see, she ran to her mother, she ran to the window, she ran to the door, she ran back to her mama, and she said, "Oh, mama, why didn't you tell me it was so beautiful?" Oh, this world is full of beauty. Full of beauty. I just can't imagine. Or as the hymn writer said, I can only imagine what heaven must be like, a place of unsurpassed beauty. I don't think there's any other place in all of God's created universe that's more beautiful than this place we call heaven. It has the glory of God. It comes down from heaven out of God. The writer of Hebrews, we don't know who that was either, Van. The writer of Hebrews says that Abraham looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Looking for a city. That's what we're doing. We're looking for this city called heaven, where we'll never die. What is heaven like? Well, it's the showcase of God's creation. It's a place of unsurpassed beauty. As the hymn writer said, I want to see heaven. Amen? Amen? Heaven. Heaven is a place of unsurpassed beauty. But then get your notes and write down number two. Heaven is a place of unmingled joy. Unsurpassed beauty, but also unmingled joy. What do you like? What do you like? Oh, I can think of a lot of things I like. How about, well, I like to eat, y'all. Or I like, wow. There's so many things that we enjoy here. Good food, a new baby, a wedding, a party, family, friends, recreations, activities. But you know, with all the things that we enjoy, there's also sorrow, right? There's pain, there's trouble, there's trials. Ever since man fell in the garden, trouble has been inescapable on this earth. But let me ask you, going to be any trouble in heaven? Any sorrow up there? No. Notice verse 4, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There'll be no more pain. There'll be no rebellion. There'll be no sin. The former things are passed away. What are some of the joys that we're going to enjoy in heaven? Look at chapter 22, verse 1. 22, verse 1. He showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street, on every side of the river, on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month, the leaves of the trees for the healing of the nations. Some would say that this water is like the water that Jesus promised the woman at the well. Whoso drinketh of the water that I shall give them shall never thirst again. This is a spiritual provision of God in heaven. Others would say, well, this is water. We're gonna eat and drink, and we're gonna enjoy the joys of heaven. And either way, I would say that heaven is a place of unmingled joy, the joy of serving our Savior. We'll never grow weary or tired or discouraged. We're going to see Him face to face, like Fanny Crosby wrote, face to face with Christ my Savior. The psalmist put it this way, in thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. A place of unmingled joy. Under the city of Rome are the ancient catacombs, the burial places, the places where Christians hid from persecution in the city of Rome. And there on the walls of the catacombs are sketches of what those persecuted Christians in the first and second and third centuries thought heaven was going to be like. Heavenly scenes. Robert Jeffress, pastor of First Baptist Dallas, has written a book on heaven. Came out just last year. I encourage you to read it. I've been reading it myself. And he said, when I saw in those catacombs beautiful landscapes, children playing, feasting, and I realized that those persecuted Christians in ancient Rome were sustained by the thoughts of heaven, a place of unmingled joy. Joy in the presence of Jesus. Joy in the presence of God's people. Heaven. Heaven is a place of unsurpassed beauty. Heaven is a place of unmingled joy. Let's add to the list. I think we'd have to say, in order for heaven to be all of that, heaven would have to be a place of undefiled holiness. Heaven will be a holy place. Will you notice there? It's a great city, holy Jerusalem, verse 10. So what's got to be left out of heaven? Well, verse 8. The cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. In order for heaven to be heaven, there's got to be a place for all those who've rejected God's forgiveness, who've rejected the changing power of the Spirit of God, who've refused to turn away from their rebellion of God. And so those who reject God's grace, God's goodness, God's gift of salvation, will be excluded from heaven because it will be a place of undefiled holiness. Verse 27, chapter 21, verse 27. There shall by no means enter it anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So there will be forever complete separation, eternal separation between the redeemed in the presence of God and the condemned, the eternal lost, in the lake of fire. Sin is forever shut out. Does anybody remember Evangelist Carl Johnson? Let me see your hand. Anybody remember Evangelist Carl Johnson? I take this story from a book by Carl Johnson entitled Prophecy Made Plain. Those of you that don't know about Carl Johnson, let me tell you about him. Carl Johnson was going to lead revival one week at Abingdon Bible Church when we were in the old building. And he called me on Saturday and he said, Pastor, would it be okay if instead of driving down from Beckley, West Virginia tonight to spend the night, I could come tomorrow and be there in time for service? He said, I bought a new car and I'm trying to get everything lined up and put in my car. He carried a lot of books with him and Bibles that he sold, for instance, the Pilgrim Bible. And he said, I'll be there in the morning and you can depend on me, and will it be okay if I spend the night at my home? What would you say? Well, okay, sure, I'll see you tomorrow. So we had the usual schedule on Sunday morning then. We had Sunday school, and then we had preaching. And so we had a Sunday school class, and at the end of Sunday school, you know, I thought, well, maybe he'll be, some of y'all remember this story? Yeah, a few of you. So I said, well, I guess he'll be here for preaching. He didn't make it for Sunday school, so it got time to start preaching service, and I looked around, he wasn't there. Well, you don't just wait, you know, you just go ahead and start preaching, sir. You know, he'll be in. I thought, when we have the offering and we pray for the offering, I prayed and I looked up and I thought, surely he'll be there. Wrong. He wasn't there. So I said, uh-oh. Kind of like praying a while ago. Pastors need to be ready to pray, preacher, die at a moment's notice. So that was today was my pray, and that Sunday was my preach, because I realized he's not going to show up. And so I've been sharing in the homes of the elderly passage of scripture from Nehemiah chapter 1. I went and grabbed some notes in my office and got back to the platform, and we finished the last song, and I got up to preach, and I said, I know you wonder where Carl Johnson is, and so am I. And at the end of the service, we were singing the closing hymn, and he walked in the door. Stood at the back with kind of a puzzled look on his face, and I introduced him and said, looking forward to hearing you preach tonight. God bless you, Brother Carl. And after the service, he said, oh no, it was time change Sunday, wasn't it? Carl Johnson tells this story about someone arriving in heaven. He said, a man by the name of Daniel Curry, a mighty man of God, dreamed. He ascended to heaven and he knocked on the gate and they asked him his name. And he said, Daniel Curry. And they went looking for his name. And he said, well, we didn't find it. And so they said, you know, if you want, he said, why don't you go over here and we'll ask you a few questions to to see if you can get into heaven. And so they started asking questions. And Daniel Curry, have you always been good? Now he's standing before God. So let me ask you that question this morning. Have you always been? No, he had to admit. Have you always been pure? No. Have you always been loving in your opinion of others? Have you always been just in your dealing with your fellow man? And he stood there and he's wilting. You know, he's thinking, oh, no. This is hopeless. And my friend, when you and I stand before God, if we're going to depend on what we've done, it is hopeless. Amen? But you know, as he stood there thinking the world was coming to an end, he heard the voice of one standing by his side. And he turned to look and he saw what he instantly recognized as Jesus. And Jesus spoke up. Hallelujah. Is he going to speak for you? Jesus spoke up and he said, Father, he said, all this man's sins, all his mistakes, every evil action and word and thought and all of his shortcomings, you put that down against me because Daniel Curry believed in me in his life on earth. He stood for me in his life on earth, and I stand for him today. Remember the words of Jesus, whosoever confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father who is in heaven. Whoever denies me before men, him will I deny before my Father which is in heaven. May I ask you, have you confessed Jesus? Have you confessed him? Have you made public your decision to put your faith and trust in him? Have you publicly confessed him? That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be what? Saved. Saved. Daniel Curry was saved by the grace of God. I hope that you today have been saved by the grace of God, because if you have not, you will not spend eternity in heaven. It is a place of undefiled holiness, reserved for those who've been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. One more thing. Number four. Number one, heaven is a place of unsurpassed beauty. Number two, a place of unmingled joy. Number three, a place of undefiled holiness. But we get to the best one of all. Number four. Heaven is a place of unending fellowship. Unending fellowship with God, our Creator, with Jesus, our Savior, and with God's people who belong to Him. Oh, there have been great times of fellowship on this world for God's people. Remember the Garden of Eden? You think God and Adam and Eve had some fellowship in the Garden of Eden? Oh, yeah. The Bible tells us that God walked. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Remember the children of Israel in the wilderness? They built a dwelling place for God in the center of the camp. God was placed there in the center where he always belongs among the people of God. And God dwelled with his people. And when they put the ark into the tabernacle, the Bible tells us that the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tabernacle meeting because the cloud rested upon it and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. The cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle by day, and the fire was over it by night in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout their journeys. Yes, the people of God in the past have experienced the presence of God in the garden, in the wilderness. Jesus came, the Bible says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That's the witness of the apostles to the presence of Jesus. God Himself dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. The glory as of the only begotten of the Son of God. What a glorious thing. The Bible tells us that you and I, even now, can experience that kind of fellowship with God. We can enjoy His presence day by day. We can walk with Him and talk with Him and experience the joy of fellowship with God. But oh, yes, it's true. Sin comes in and breaks that fellowship. It interferes with our walk with God. Truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. But if we say we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. It's limited. It's limited by distraction. Do you ever get distracted when you were praying? When you're reading the Bible? When you're worshiping God? This world distracts us from God. But not in heaven. Unending fellowship. Sin interrupts our fellowship. And even when we're walking in fellowship with God here, the Apostle Paul says, we see through a glass dimly. But then, face to face, now we know in part. But then shall we know even as we are known. Jacob, Gideon, Moses saw God face to face on specific occasions. But you and I, in the presence of God, will enjoy unending fellowship. There will be nothing to end our fellowship with God. Look at verse 3, 21:3. 21:3. I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them. They shall be His people. God Himself will be with them and be their God. Look at verse 7. He overcomes. He's talking about the victory we have in Jesus for all of God's people. He overcomes, shall inherit all things, and I'll be His God, and He shall be my son. Chapter 21, verse 22 says, I saw no temple in it. For the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. Earlier in the book of Revelation, we've seen a temple in heaven. But when this new heaven and new earth are created, there's no temple there because there's no interference between us and God. To be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. And Paul says about the coming of Jesus, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. It's the presence of God that makes heaven heaven, amen? And it's the fellowship we will have with God and His people that will be unending. D.L. Moody said this. He said, the light of heaven is the face of Jesus. The joy of heaven is the presence of Jesus. The melody of heaven is the name of Jesus. The harmony of heaven is the praise of Jesus. The theme of heaven is the work of Jesus. The employment of heaven is the eternity of Jesus. The fullness of heaven is Jesus Christ Himself. A little girl had three older brothers that were always glad to show off their knowledge. And so they decided to quiz her about the names of teams in their cities. So they would name a city, and it was her job to name the team. So they started out with Detroit, and she said Lions, Chicago Bears, Kansas City Chiefs, Miami Dolphins, New Orleans. She couldn't come up with it. And so one of her brothers says, well, you know, it's the people that are in heaven. She said, oh, yeah, the New Orleans Grandpas. I hope there'll be some grandmas up there too, right? Some moms and dads. Oh, how much we long to see heaven. I want to play a song for you. Trudy wants to sing it, so someone give her a mic and she can sing along with Chris Dorton here just in a minute. Chris Dorton was having his final concert down at First Baptist Jacksonville, Florida. He would live only a few months after this concert. And one of the songs that he sung that I love to hear, Trudy and I, we listened to it this morning in preparation for church at home. And it's that beautiful song, I Want to See Heaven. So play it, and I'm going to hand Trudy a microphone so she can, you know, hum along. Y'all got it?
If Jesus comes tomorrow,
Amen. Now, you had a couple things to fill out at the bottom of your page, and then we'll sing and pray and be done. Lessons. The wonders of heaven sustains us in our trials. You got trouble in your life? Thinking about heaven sustains us in our trials. Number two, it comforts us in our sorrows. Have you lost anyone? Has death taken away someone from your family or friends? Thinking about heaven sustains us in our trials, comforts us in our sorrows. Number three, it changes our goals. What are we working for? What are we looking for? Number four, it spurs us. It spurs us to evangelism. It spurs us to missions. It spurs us to tell the lost about Jesus. May God help us do that. Now we got to sing. I mean, y'all got to sing just a little, just a verse or two before we can go and pray for Yurik and Anna. And so 542, when we all get to heaven, let's sing just before we go. 542. Let's stand to sing. Verse 1. You know Jesus, if you don't, you come and trust him this morning. Y'all come on up. Monty and Brenda are coming up to have prayer for them. Buddy Moore has given me this note. He says, when I get in the presence of Jesus, I want Jesus to hug me and tell me you've done well, my faithful servant. What love is this? Amen. Well done. Good and faithful. Thankfully he died for me. It's amazing love. Rest in his presence. Monty's praying for Yurik and Anna. Michael, where are you going to be when this service is done? You be in the welcomes out here in the foyer so folks can see you and hug you. We prayed for Michael at the end of our presentation last Sunday night. All right, Monty, pray for them, and we'll be dismissed. God bless you.
Father, as we pause and bow before you for a moment, we just acknowledge that we do all look forward to our time in heaven, and as we've been reminded when we're there, there are no more goodbyes, no more farewells. And as we say farewell today to Mike, and we're thankful for the time he's had here, for the wisdom of his father to have him come here this year before school, and the way that he has won all of our hearts, and we've enjoyed fellowship with him. And we think also of Yurik and Anna and their family as they return to Canada, and a new ministry that you have directed them to by your grace. And as they fly in there to that airport, we ask that you would have just the right person there to work through that visa process for them. And so for them and for Mike, as they go back, we ask that you would continue to go before them and prepare the way and show yourself strong on their behalf as you have done so graciously in the past. And they go with their love. You know how much we love them, and we know that they're going with your care. So We thank you, Father, for the privilege of being with them for this little while. And we just give you all the praise because you alone are worthy to receive the praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.